So everybody, you guessed it. You will see your booklet has a number of questions and activities in. But over today and tomorrow, we are going to focus on the first topic over here on your index page, which is the analysis and interpretation. And then tomorrow, we're going to focus on reconciliations, right? So let's quickly look at, and let's start with our first topic. Our first topic is obviously also a paper one topic. And it is such an important topic, but it's also a topic that we have noticed over the years, and even your teachers have noticed that you find it a little bit challenging. So I'm really here today to help you find easy, simple ways to do it and enjoy it, because that's what it's all about. You need to enjoy what you are doing. Okay. So let's move on. I'm going to first just spend a few minutes over here. But before I get to that, I just show you. We briefly looked at the formula sheet now, where I challenged you to name the different formulas and what answers they actually give us. So when we do those formulas, they're going to answer certain questions. Okay. So what I did is I actually took the formula sheet and I took a sheet that Miss Mandy made about 2 years ago, and I just rearranged it a little bit and just put my own flair to it. And we will make the sheet available should the teachers want to make use of it in the classroom. And it's all color coded. So what I did is I actually asked myself, what do these different, why do we do these different ratios and different formulas? And I placed them in order according to the answers that they provide to the questions that we ask. So when it comes to profitability asks the question, is the business or the company profitable? Is the business or the company reaching its target margins? And then you will see I color-coded it with yellow. So all these under here, all these formulas with their names will be able to answer these questions. Okay. And the same with liquidity. Is the business able to pay its short-term debts? Do the current assets exceed the current liabilities? And you will see your different formulas with their name indicated here on the page, and so on with solvency, as well as gearing and risk or risk. And then lastly, your return. So what I want to focus on with all of you today is I want you to get to the opportunity of getting all your easy marks, okay? Getting all the easy marks. And I'm sure you know, and I'm sure your teacher also indicated to you that every question paper has three tiers. So 30% would be your easier questions, 40% would be your moderate questions, and 30% would be your more challenging questions. I don't like saying difficult. I just like saying it's a little bit more challenging. Okay. But we are going to focus on and get you strong in getting that 50% and making sure you pass every question in the paper coming up in September, as well as the paper at the end of the year. So let's just quickly go through a few important things that you must bear in mind when doing analysis and interpretation. Now, first of all, where will we get the information? Where will we get the information or the figures to do to answer these questions and also to do the formulas and the calculations. So first of all, it would be your statement of comprehensive income, as well as your statement of financial position. And in certain cases, the cash flow statement. Now, I'm sure you have gone through all of those topics in class already, so you have a good idea. Other thing that is also very important is, in order to get your information, you must also know the formats of these statements. Know your formats, because that's also just going to make it so much easier to go and get the information. So I'm going to go through a very simple example here, and just a few tips that you can make use of when you have these questions in front of you. So there's just a little bit of a guide here, a guide on how to answer and analyze and interpret a typical question. Very important, read the question and underline what is required. You can either underline or you can make use of a highlighter. Identify the appropriate financial indicators that will help you answer the question. Compare the selected financial indicator to the previous year's results or for the two companies. And then number four, comment on whether the indicator has increased or decreased. Does the increase or decrease result in an improvement or decline in the financial results? And comment on what caused the improvement or decline. Give advice where needed. Now, the example that we have here is a question that you will definitely find either in your September question page or at the end of the financial year. Some of you might have already come across this question in the June paper. So what do they expect from us here? Explain your opinion on which company has the best dividend payout policy. Now, in order to identify the best dividend payout policy, we will have to do a calculation. So we have some information for Winston Limited and Marley Limited. Dividends per share and earnings per share is what we will need in order to answer this question regarding the dividend payout policy. So if we look at the solution they gave us, they suggest calculate the dividend payout policy, as I mentioned. And what do we make use of? We make use of the dividends per share as well as the earnings per share. But there is a formula that is connected to this that you will have to know. And that formula is very simple. DPS over EPS. And we are looking for a percentage, so therefore we need to multiply it with 100, okay? And that will give us the percentage. We are going to first look at Winston. So we're going to go and get Winston's dividends per share, that 130 over 194, and we multiply it with 100, and we will find that the answer is 67%, and the same with Marley. Now, by looking at the answers of Winston and Marley, you will find that Winston pays out 67% of the earnings, whereas Marley pays 96% of the earnings. Therefore, Marley Limited has the best dividend payout. Why? Because it's the highest dividend payout. Okay. So very simple. And I think many times when you come across this question, you feel overwhelmed, but it shouldn't overwhelm you, because you might definitely get a question like this in your September exam or at the end of the year. So what I want to do now is I want to move on to the questions. This is the type of things we're going to look at today, but we're going to point out the easy questions that you can do. And at the end of the day, you're going to see, oh, I don't really need this extra tutoring. I can do it. And that is what I want you I want you to feel like I can do this. I can do this. It is not challenging. If I know my formula sheet, if I know my formulas, if I know that these formulas go with these type of indicators, then I am just going to win at this. And this topic, when it comes to the exams, will not scare me at all. Okay, so first of all, in activity one, there is a very straightforward, simple testing of your knowledge regarding those formulas and answers or questions that they ask that we are going to quickly go through. I will do this one for you, activity one. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to go through activity one, some of the questions that I'll do for you. And then I'm going to give you a few minutes and give you the opportunity to do some activities or some of the questions in activity two. So we're going to move between the two activities. So let's start. They ask you, and I'm going to make use of my highlighter, choose a term from column B. So they want a term from column B that matches the description in column A. Write only the letter. Now, learners, I've noticed, and I don't know if your teachers have also noticed, you don't always follow the instructions. So, for example, they only want you to indicate A, B, C, or D. They do not want you to write out the entire word or the sentence or the phrase. They just want you to indicate A, B, C, or D. Okay, just to make it quicker and simpler for you as well as for your teachers who need to mark your question papers. So let's see. 1.1 asks ability of the business to pay off its debts. And not any debts, all its debts, right? So all its debts. Now you need to go back and think, okay, this is the question. What is my answer? So here's my question. I'm taking you back to this. Solvency. Is the business or the company able to pay off all its debts? Now, unfortunately, you will not have a sheet like this in the exam, but if you link it to the sheet that I showed you earlier, and you know it by heart, and you also know why you use those formulas, you will be able to answer simple questions like this, okay? And you'll get those four marks. So the ability of the business to pay off all its debts, that's going to be solvency, right? Because it's all the debts. It's not just the short-term date, it's all debt. So I'm going to go to my answer book and I'm going to write in my answers over here. So 1.1 would be C. Then we move on. Ability of the business to pay off all its short-term debts. So all its short-term debts. Now, when it comes to short-term debts, we know we are working with liquidity. So our next answer would be D for 1.1.2. We're done with that one. Next up, the benefit that shareholders receive for investing in the company. The benefit, or I would even say the reward. Okay. And that would be return on investment or return on equity, which will be B. And then last but not least, the extent to which a company is financed by loans. And that will be indicating gearing, which is A, gearing, or I would also like to say the risk that the company is taking. So there is your first answers. I'm sure, I'm hoping you all agree with me regarding that. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm not going to give you the opportunity immediately to answer the activity in 2 point, in activity two. I'm first going to go on and do some calculations with you. Now, some of these calculations, learners, you will see at least two or three of them comes from grade 10, grade 11, and this is calculations that you've been doing since then. So these should be your definite marks that you're going to get in the exam as you know them since grade 10. So I'm going to move on. Read Limited, you are provided with information relating to Read Limited for the financial year ending 30 June 2022. Now, yeah, this is so important. Where financial indicators are required to support your answer, name the financial indicator, the actual figure or the ratio, percentage, and very important, the trend. Now, what do they mean with the trend? Whether there was an increase or a decrease? Was there improvement or was there a drop? So I'm going to turn the page. Let's see. Now, I'm first going to go through with you number 1.2.1. I'm going to do all of these for you, and then I'm going to give you an opportunity to do it on your own. And then, Mr. Royson, we can see definitely the competitive edge amongst the schools will come out, and we're going to see who shines first. So let's see. They expect me to calculate the following: asset test ratio, the debt equity ratio, percentage return on average shareholders' equity. This one you will most definitely get in the exam, as well as a share, because they are your grade 12 ratios. And then your asset test ratio, we've been learning that since grade 10, and your debt equity, if I'm correct, came in grade 11. So it will not be the first time that you see these guys. And we are going to go through them, and we're first going to remind ourselves, okay, what is the formula? What is the formula that I need? So I'm going to go to my formula sheet, and I'm going to go and look for my formula. Now, first of all, the asset test ratio, they actually give you two options here. It's your current assets minus inventory to your current liabilities. And they also give you another option where they just inform you it would be your trade and other receivables. In other words, basically your debtors, right? Plus your cash and cash equivalents to your current liabilities. Now, I also want you to ask yourself, where must I go and get this information? I will now need to go and get this information from my balance sheet, or even the notes to the balance sheet, should they provide it to you. And they only want the asset test ratio for June 2022. When you go to your information on page five, you are going to see that they give you information for June, for the end of 2021, and then for the information and the amounts for 2022. So here we go. They are very nice. They even give us the current assets, and they give us the current liabilities. And they also, as you know, you will have to take away the inventory Or you can just add up those two amounts and make use of that, because that is what the asset test ratio is made up of. So let me do this one. So first of all, I'm just going to remind you of the formula. So it will be my current assets, and I'm going to shorten it. Do forgive me. Current assets minus my trading stock or my inventory, whatever name you feel comfortable with, to my current liabilities. So I know now where I need to go and get it. This is the extract from the statement of financial position, and I'm going to make use of these amounts. So current assets currently is 1,015,000. I'm going to write that down, 1,015,000. And learners, please do not worry, because we don't expect you to provide the formula in the exam or in a test. It's not necessary. To my current, no apologies. Oh, goodness. I must first subtract my trading stock. My trading stock currently is 564,000. To my current liabilities of 635,200. And I'm going to grab my calculator, because you will need your calculator. And I don't have a fancy calculator like you guys. I have this guy. So it is 1,015,000. Did I miss a zero? Yeah, yes, I did. 15,000 minus 564,000. Oh, goodness. Oh, apologies. Cell phone is not even on silent. Right. That's going to give you 451,000 to 635,200. Now, what I tell my learners is I ask them, how many times does this amount go into itself? This amount goes into itself, 635,200, once. And what I do over here, I also need to do over here. So 635,200. And learners, you don't have to do it this way. I'm just explaining to you what you need to do. So you need to divide this amount into itself, the current liabilities, and what you do with the current liabilities, also need to do on the side of the current assets minus the trading stock. And you're going to find it's going to give you an answer of 0,7. So very simple, to the point. There we go. Okay. I'm sure everybody is busy doing this with me. I'm going to move on now to the debt equity ratio. Now, the debt equity ratio is all about the relationship between what is my debt compared to my own equity. Okay. The question that is being answered is, am I relying as a business or as a company, am I relying on borrowed capital? Am I relying on capital? Now, obviously, if the company or the business is relying on borrowed capital, right, it is a little bit more risky. But if the company relies on its own capital instead of the loan or borrowed capital, then they are not in such a risky position, right? So let's quickly do that one. So calculate the debt equity ratio. Once again, I'm going to ask myself, where do I get this information? I am going to go to my information sheet, And again, this information is going to come from the extract from the statement of financial position. And I'm going to show you where to get those amounts now. I'm just going to remind you of the formula. So I'm reminding you of the formula. It's going to be obviously my non-current liabilities to my shareholders' equity. Oh, goodness. Shareholders' equity. Okay. So I'm going to quickly go to my information sheet. I'm going to go and look for my non-current liabilities. My non-current liabilities in this case would be my loan, the loan of 800,000. So I'm going to write that down, 800,000. Oh, 8 million, goodness. 800,000, oh, 8 million to my shareholders' equity, which is also provided here for me. Here's my shareholders' equity. There we go. And it's still in the 2022 column. They don't want the debt equity ratio for 2021. They want the debt equity ratio for 2022. So we're not going to look at these amounts right now. So my amount over there is 10,050,750. And once again, I'm going to do what I did here at the top, right? I'm going to ask myself, how many times does this amount go into itself? I'm really breaking it down for you guys today. So it goes into itself once. And how many times does this 10 million go into the 8 million? So again, what we do over here, we're going to do on this side. And you will find if you put it in your calculator, let's do it together. 8 million divided by the 10,050,750 gives me 0.8. So we're going to round it off to 0.8. And if I had to answer a question here, if they would give me a question to, for example, that says, is this business more dependent on borrowed capital or own capital? And the answer would be own capital. So in this case, they are relying on own capital. And that is a question you can get in the exam, definitely. Now, before I hand over to you, I'm quickly going to run through these two as well, do these calculations with you. And once this is also, like I said earlier, calculations that's going to come up in the exam, and you must be ready for them, okay? It might be that you don't get everything perfect, but don't leave any spaces out. Try. So we're going to run through the return on average shareholders' equity, and we're going to go through the net asset value per share. So first of all, again, we're going to ask ourselves, what is the formula? Now, again, learners, you only have the formula sheet, so you really need to link the name to the formula, right? So let's quickly go to our formula sheet. Let's go look for it. So here we go. It has to do with return, right? And our formula would be the net income after tax over the average shareholder's equity. Now you're asking me, ma'am, how do I get average shareholders' equity? Don't stress, I'm going to show you. But first, where do we get the information? So they want the net income after tax. Or also the net profit after tax over the average. Shareholders' equity. Where will we get net income after tax? Now, if you know your formulas, or not your formulas, your format, you will know that my net profit after tax is found in my statement of comprehensive income. And lucky for you, here we have an extract from the statement of comprehensive income for June 2022. And here's our amount that we're going to make use of. So net profit after tax, we're going to make use of this amount, as well as the average shareholder's equity. Now, as you might have asked yourself, where do I get average or how do I get average? Here is my shareholder's equity, and they give me the amounts for 2021. And the amounts for 2022. Basically, this is your opening amount or your opening balance. And this is your closing balance. And how do I get an average? I take my opening balance and my closing balance. Plus my closing balance. And I divide that by 2. Or I can multiply it by 1/2. Whatever way you feel most comfortable with. Nobody is forcing you to divide it by 2. Or to multiply it by 1/2, but you must choose one of the two options to get your average. Okay, so we're going to do that. We are going to do that. So we're going to start with our net income after tax, which was given to us very quick and easy. We're going to copy and paste that amount. 444,500 over. I don't even have my ruler, over the average. Now we're going to write down both amounts. So I'm going to just multiply it with 1/2. So I'm just going to say 0.5 times the opening balance plus the closing balance. Opening balance, here we have it. 9,540,000. Plus the 10,050,000. There we go. I first want you to get the answer for that. So we keep the, and we must not forget to multiply it with 100, eh? Why am I multiplying it with 100? Because I'm looking for a percentage. They asked me to calculate the percentage return on average shareholders' equity. So I'm going to keep my amount at the top. And if you want to, you can immediately give the answer because I know you all have very smart calculators these days and you don't use these old calculators like I do. But you're going to find that your answer here at the bottom will be 979,53,75. I'm going to divide this into that and I'm going to multiply it once again with 100/1 in order to get my percentage. The percentage you're going to be left with is 4.5%. And if I can please urge you, when you do these calculations and they ask you to provide a percentage or provide the cents or the turns or the turnover rate, you need to provide it in the days when the percentages, when. So please do not forget to indicate your percentage, because that is what they asked of you. They asked the percentage. And I don't want you to lose unnecessary marks because you did not indicate the percentage. Okay? So there's your answer for the return on average shareholders' equity. And we can quickly move on to calculate the net asset value per share, because I also at the same time need to keep my eye on the clock, but we still have time. So let's quickly remind ourselves, what is the formula for my net asset value per share? So we're going to go to our formula sheet. And yes, like I said, I will make this available. And net asset value will also indicate to us the return, okay? So it will be your ordinary shareholders' equity for 2022, don't forget, over the number of issued shares. And that will also be available in your calculation or in the information given to you. So let's remind ourselves, we're going to write down the formula first. And this is just for good practice. You don't have to do it when I give you an opportunity to do the calculations on your own. It's just good practice, because by practicing and going looking at the formula, you are going to just strengthen yourself and bolden yourself and get that confidence you need to go into the exams. So ordinary shareholders' equity. Over number of issued shares. Right. So let's start. Ordinary shareholders' equity, we've come across this amount quite a few times already in our debt equity and in our percentage return on average shareholders' equity. So we have the amount. There is the amount, and just once again to remind you where to get it, here is the amount from the extract from the financial statement of financial position. So we're going to write that in 10,050,750 over the number of issued shares. Now, that is something we now need to go and look at. They gave us some information that we will make use of. So here you will see at the top of the information sheet, they gave you some information regarding the share as well as the dividends. So let's see what they say. At the beginning of the financial year, on the 1st of July, we had 900,000 shares that were in issue. And during the financial year, we actually repurchased 75,000 shares. And later on, before the end of the financial year, we actually issued additional shares. And that we need to keep in mind. So we're going to make use of this amount, as well as this amount that was issued during the financial year or towards the end of the financial year. So how am I going to get that? So at the end, you're going to see it's going to be 950,000 shares that were in issue. And once again, if you weren't sure where I got it or how I got this amount, it was my number of issued shares in the beginning of the year, which was 900,000. Then I repurchased 75,000 shares. So those 75,000 shares will not be in issue anymore. So I take them out. But also later in the financial year, I issued an additional 125,000 shares, right? And if we add that up, and I'll do it quickly with you, if we add that up and subtract where we need to, you're going to see we're going to end up back at the 950,000. So we start with 900,000. We take away the shares that was repurchased because they are not in issue anymore. And we are left with 825,000. But then we add those shares that we issued later in the financial year, 125,000. And that gives you the 950,000 if you were not sure how I got to that amount. Okay. Don't worry, I'm going to give you an opportunity to work on your own in a few seconds. Don't forget, we need to multiply this with 100 because we are looking for cents. So my answer over here is going to be 1,058 cents. You can provide me with this answer or provide your teacher with this answer, but don't forget to add the cents. Or you could, if you said, or if you say 10 rand and 58 cents, that would also not be wrong, but I want to encourage you to make use of the first answer. Okay, guys, I am going to hand over to you now. And I'm first going to challenge the schools to give me the answers of activity 2. You're going to see if you turn to page 4 in your answer book, there is activity 2. And if you go to the workbook itself, if you turn to page, here we go, page 6, there we go. If you turn to page 6, there is the analysis and interpretation, activity 2. I want to challenge you to quickly get these easy marks. And let's see, Mr. Royson, which school is going to answer us first. I'm going to hand over to the schools for a few minutes and let's see who is the fastest school. Let's give them 2 minutes. So our questions here asked the following. What do they want from us? What do they expect from us? What is required? 3 financial statements are provided as options in which each of the following items would appear. Choose the financial statement and write down only the letter A, B, or C next to the question. So let's quickly see. Now, the first question that they asked us was profit on sale of fixed asset. Now, once again, this is also testing your format knowledge. So I know your teachers tell you, know your format, and I know you write for tests, and I know you might think, oh, it's just my teacher that's doing this. It's not just your teacher. I promise you, all the teachers want you guys to know the format. It is so important. So profit on sale of fixed assets will be found in the statement of comprehensive income, right? because if it was a loss on a sale of a fixed asset, it would have also been in the statement of comprehensive income. So my first answer here would be B. Next up, amount due to shareholders for the final dividend, dividends payable. Now, payable meaning that the dividends have not been paid as of yet. So I owe my shareholders, as a company, I owe my shareholders. And think of the format, where will we get that format, or where will we get that in what statement? In that statement, it would be the statement of financial position. So those who had A year would be correct. Well done. Moving on. Total amount spent on repurchase of shares. Now, the total amount is provided in the cash flow statement, or you could have said in the statement of financial position in the notes. Okay, you will get that in the notes, the ordinary share capital note and the retained income note, but then you need to take the two amounts and add them together. But if you want the amount on its own, then you need to go to the cash flow statement. So you could have said C, or you could have said A. Last one, the total income tax amount for the current financial year. So that is the total income tax amount we should have paid. Doesn't mean we have paid it yet, or we might have paid more than we should have. That you will find in the statement of comprehensive income, which will be B. So let's quickly double check. Mr. Royson, can you see who had all of them right?
Yes, it looks like Craven B and Ms. Evie Gordon. And then Bardell as well. Bardell, hi.
Well done. I'm sending you all a little heart because we don't have gifts today. But well done. That is brilliant. That is really, really good. Learners, before I give you the next challenge, I just want to step back for a moment to the first calculations and short questions that we work through. And I want to just give you a little bit of a motivation. So this question that we have over here in activity one, right, is out of, I think it's out of 40, if I'm correct. So let's just double check. Sorry for the noise. No, it's actually out of 50, right? So let's see, for example, if you now did an exam and you know for sure you got all of this right, let's add up what percentage you already have just for this question. So it's 4 + 4 + 3 + 5 + 3. It gives you 19. So 19 out of 50, that will already give you 38%. So that will already give you 38% if you know these and you are comfortable with them, comfortable answering the short questions, and also comfortable with these calculations. That's a definite 38%. And that is really something to look forward to. And you will also see that usually the question papers are set out that we build your confidence a little bit first, and then we get to the little bit more challenging calculations and questions. So I'm going to now challenge you, and let's see, Mr. Royston. I must now did the first activity, these first few calculations. I'm going to challenge the learners and the schools, and I would like you to go and try the following. Number 2.2.1, Let's see, here they go, here we go. They require you at Sunset Limited to do the following. The financial year ended the 28th of February 2023, and they would like you to calculate, so only calculate the financial indicators for the year ending 28th February 2023. Now, once again, you're going to see with the information that they provide you, specifically here with the extract from the statement of financial position, they give you two amounts, right? But we are only looking for the financial indicators regarding 2023. So I'm going to give you guys, let's see. Let's give you 2 minutes. 2 minutes for the first one. And then let's get our answer back, and then we'll indicate the rest of the minutes, because I want us to get the answers. I don't want you to go off on your own for too long.
Right.
So I'm going to give you two minutes for the first one. Oh my goodness. So they actually don't need us, sir. They don't need us. They're too clever. I mean, that is amazing. Let's hear what. Do we have an answer? Can we get an answer?
Yes, we have. So the first school is Rosendale High, and their answer is 23.3%. Delft High has exactly the same, as well as Jonga High, as well as Bordel and Marion High as well. Rosendale even provided us with the calculation as well.
I mean, they don't need us. They're way too clever. And they were on holiday for almost 3 weeks. Wow,
it just shows they still know their work.
No, definitely. Well done to everybody. Wow, to all those schools, you are brilliant. Okay, so I'm going to keep the challenges going for the schools. Let's challenge them with the next one. Let's challenge them with net asset value per share. Let's see who can do it in 2 minutes.
Rosendale is on it again. They are already providing answers as well as Bordel.
Rosendale, you must give her others a chance, eh? You must give give her others a chance. No, I'm playing. It's good. I like the competitive spirit that we have here amongst the schools. And at the end of the day, we are still all friends. So that's wonderful. So our answer there.
So Rosendale's answer. Rosendale's answer is 695.6% or cent, they said, as well as Bordel. Is BAM, I don't know what school are you from, as well as Sydney Jonga High. All of them have exactly the same answer, but Rosendale has provided us with the calculation as well.
Yo, Rosendale, you are just a step ahead. Well done. That is brilliant. Yes, that's the right answer. Just be careful. It's not percent, it is cent. Okay, it is not percent, it is cents. And then lastly, I'm going to quickly ask for the debt equity ratio.
We already have an answer for that as well.
Wow.
So Mary and I gave us the first answer as well as Bordel High, and both say 0.4 is the one. And Senior Jonga High, as well as Evie Gordon as well.
Okay, that is brilliant. That is brilliant. I will also do the calculations for those who might have missed it. But I want to quickly throw in a question here. Which one of the schools can tell me with the debt equity ratio that we just calculated? Is this a business that relies on its own capital, or does it rely on borrowed capital? What is the gearing? I would like to know that answer. So I'm going to throw that out there, and then I will quickly do those calculations.
Delphi says own.
They are relying on their own capital.
As well as Ms. Evie Gordon also says own.
Well done, well done, well done. So it is a low risk. They're not, this company is not depending on borrowed capital. That is brilliant. Well done, everybody. I'm quickly going to just go through these calculations. I'm going to go quick. Now, in the previous activity, I showed you the formula as well, but I'm not going to do that now because we need to get going a little bit quicker. So let's quickly look at this first one. We need to calculate the percentage operating profit on sales. So we know our answer needs to be a percentage, right? And it has to do with operating profit and sales. Where do we get this information? We get this information in the statement of comprehensive income. For those of you who weren't sure, but I think all of them are sure as they are very quick today with their answers. That's brilliant. So I'm going to go to my information sheet. I'm quickly going to look for my operating profit. And you don't, you just by reading what they want, they are already telling you what the formula looks like. So operating profit on sales. So operating profit is standing on the head of sales. So we're going to go to our information. Here's our operating profit, 2,033,900. And then we also have our sales amount, which is the 8,725,000. So we're literally just going to fill those amounts in. Now, I know I might have gone a little bit slow today as I started with the lesson, but I just want everybody to grasp it. So there we go. We multiplied with 100 over 1 because we are looking for a percentage. And the answer earlier provided was 23.3, and that is perfect. Well done. So those of you who weren't sure, here is the calculation. Okay, we're moving on. I'm going through it rather quickly. So net asset value per share. Let's look at this guy. So we're going to make use of the shareholders' equity at the top. And the common denominator would be the shares in issue. And once again, we're going to multiply it with 100 because we are looking for cents. Be careful. It's not percent. It is cents. So let's quickly see our shareholders' equity for 2023, don't forget, is 8,625,000. We're going to put that down. And luckily, I have my ruler here. Makes things a little bit neater. So 8,625,000 over our number of shares in issue. Now, our number of shares in issue at the end of the financial year that was actually given to us was 1,240,000. 1,240,000. There we go. For those of you who weren't sure how to get to it, we multiplied with 100 over 1. And our cents will then be 6,956. Okay. I hope everybody is happy with that. Last but not least, our debt equity ratio. Let's quickly go into that one. Our loan at the current moment for 2023 was the 3.5 million. And then, of course, there's your shareholders' equity. We're going to make use of that as well. So those are my two amounts, 3.5 million to 5,625,000. This amount goes into itself once. Okay. I'm not going to go through the whole calculation I did earlier. And it goes into this amount 0.4 times. So if you want to, you can write your answer here as well. But you should actually. So there we go. Brilliant. So those of you who weren't, there it is once again. This amount goes into itself once. And what I do over here, I need to do on this side as well. And as we discussed earlier, this is low geared, it's low risk. This company relies on its own capital instead of borrowed capital. Right. Now, guys, we're going to go back to activity one once again. And we are going to quickly continue with the questions that they have here for us. Now, here is where they want us to, you know, quote and discuss, you know, whether liquidity or solvency or so on has improved. These are the type of questions where we're going to have to write down some of our thoughts and discuss it if need be. So what I do in a question like this, I first of all, very importantly, I read, what do they expect from me? They expect the following from me. I'm just going to get the question here in front of me. Okay, we're going to just go back to our question. Here we go. Okay. Number 2.2. So we're going back to activity one. The company's liquidity has improved. Now, they tell me. They actually tell me. They don't want to know, has it improved? They tell me it has improved. And they want you to quote 3 financial indicators to support this statement. Now, you cannot just quote the names of the formulas or the indicators. You need to go a step further because you need to indicate, you need to show that you support this statement that they have made. So we're going to go and we're going to turn the page. We are going to go to this sheet on page 6. And here they show us the financial indicators that have been calculated on the 30th of June, the different years. This was last year, and this is the current year, right? Now, we recently, or in our first few calculations here, we calculated the asset test ratio, we calculated the debt equity ratio, the return on shareholders' equity, and the net asset value per share. So what I want you to do is I want you to quickly go and just fill in those answers there. So the first one for asset test that we calculated was 0.7:1. Okay. The next one that we calculated was debt equity, 0.8:1. And the last two was the return on average shareholders' equity. We're going to also fill that in, 4.5%. And we're moving on to the last one, net asset value, which was 1,058 cents, right? So those are the ones we recently calculated. So just that they are there, and now you can properly compare. Now, if I go back to the sheet that I showed you a little bit earlier, there are things that we must remember when it comes to this question, right? They want us to quote we will have to compare, and we can even go as far as to show the trends. Now, what do I mean with trends? What was the increase? Was there a decrease? But we know that the company has, or they've already indicated that the liquidity has improved. So that's, we know that there was improvement, right? So I am going to quickly show you how I answer this question, and then hopefully it will assist you in the future. Hopefully it will assist you in the future. So here's my answer sheet. What I do is I split this piece. Now, you don't have to do it like this, but I like just splitting it up a bit, because remember, learners, you also need to be, you need to show and have your answers in very structured. You know, it needs to be neat. You don't want your teacher to open your answer book and say, oh goodness, where must I start? You want to have a neat answer, but you can work fast and keep it neat. So let's just remind ourselves what indicators will indicate whether there was an improvement in liquidity. So we're going to have to go look at our current ratio, our asset test ratio, stock holding, stock turnover rate, debtors collection, or creditors payment. Those are the financial indicators that indicate whether there was an improvement in liquidity or not. So we're going to specifically go and focus on those. So we're going to go back to our information. I know you might feel, oh, ma'am, you're taking your time. We know this, but I'm just reminding you. So here we go. We're going to go and look at the current ratio, the asset test ratio, the stock turnover rate, debtors collection, and creditors payment period. So we need to quote three financial indicators. Not one, not two, but three. Three financial indicators. So if you look at your current ratio, is your current ratio in the financial year ending 2021, there was 0.3 assets for every one liability. Oof, not too good. But now look at 2022. For every one liability, there is 1.6 assets to cover that one liability. So that is a very nice improvement. So we're going to definitely write down current ratio. And we're also going to move on. We're going to also show the asset test ratio, because asset test ratio also indicates liquidity. Asset test ratio, look at that. There was also improvement. With the stock turnover, there was an improvement. But very noticeable, look at our debtors collection. In 2022, we waited 43 days for our debtors to pay us the amount that they owe us. In 2022, the business is on the ball. They are reminding the debtors to pay their bills. They are sending out, they are making phone calls, sending out emails. Now our debtors pay us within 36 days, which is brilliant. So we're going to write down those indicators. A current ratio, asset test ratio, and we're also going to write down the debtors collection period. So we're going to write down the names first. Asset test, as well as debtors collection. And we're going to not only quote the financial indicators, but we need to support this statement by providing figures and trends. So you see, learners, we can't just stop here, because you obviously want to get all six of the marks that you can earn over here. So here you are halfway, but you want to go all the way and get all the marks. So we're going to indicate this by telling, by saying that there was an improvement or there was an increase. So I'm going to start with my current ratio. If we look at the information here, there it is at the top. I'm going to say, yeah, there's improvement. They improved from 0.321 in 2021 to 1.6 to 1 in 2022. Now, there's your answer. I indicated my first financial indicator. I showed the trend, okay? And I provided figures, right? So now we're going to just do that with the asset test and then with the debtors collection. You do not have to put it in a table like this. I just like putting it in a table like this to just keep it nice and neat. So we're going to say, yeah, there's an improvement as well with the asset test ratio. There was an improvement from 0.121 in 2021 to 0.8 to 1 in 2022. Once again, I quoted my financial indicator, I provided the trend, and there's my figures, right? So quote the figure or the indicator, provide your trend, and show me the figures, the information, or the then last but not least, debtors collection. I wrote a little bit more here. Debtors pay back within 36 days in 2022. Compared to the 43 days in 2021, there is an improvement of 7 days. Brilliant. So there we go. There you have your six marks. And I'm going to quickly show you just exactly how you get your marks over there. So I'm going to just show you quickly. For your indicators, I'm going to quickly get my red pen, just so you know. There, for the financial indicator, and for my trend and figures, I also get a mark. So why would you want to only get those three marks when you can get all six? Okay? It is that simple. So remember to quote, to provide a figure, and to show the trends. So let's move on. I hope there's no questions regarding number 1.2.2. You are well.
Just Ms. Meyer. Ms. Meyer,
yes.
Just a correction. Excelsior says that the asset test ratio for 2022 is 0.7 and not 0.8. And then Mr. The BA also says the same.
And look at this. I even said to myself, go and look. So yeah, at the top. You see where I looked at. Ay, ay, ay. I looked at my debt equity ratio. Sis for me. I'm so sorry. Thank you, colleagues, for correcting me. And thank you, learners. So look at that. We're just going to say 0.7 to 1. I do apologize. My eyes went to the wrong answer. So you will see in this question specifically, many a times you might have calculated something here at the top, right? And you need to provide it in a question that is asked a little bit later. So do bear that in mind. So I even said here for myself, when I prepared to look at 1.2.1. Right. Thank you so much. But I'm sure now in the exams, you guys, all of you ladies and gents, young people, you are going to get full marks for this question, that because you definitely get something like this in the future, whether it's going to be in September or whether it's going to be at the end of the end of the year. Right. Now, what do they want from us if we go a little bit further? If we go a little bit further, expect from us. This is something that is definitely going to pop up. And I know we spoke about it earlier when the lesson started. They want us to go and look at the dividend policy, right? The dividend policy calculates or provide calculations to show the change in the dividend policy, payout policy. That is 4 marks. We're first going to look at that part. And then they want us to explain why the directors decided to change the policy. State 1 point with figures. So we're going to first look at that first one. We're going to look at this guy. We're going to provide them with a calculation to show the change in the dividend payout policy. And then we will provide 1 point with figures to explain why the directors decided to change the policy. So here we go. We are going to first of all remind ourselves of the ratio or the formula that we need to make use of. The formula that we need to make use of, here they give us ample space to calculate that. And I'm again going to take this space and I'm going to just divide it into two, because I need to see what was the dividend payout policy in 2021 compared to 2022, right? To see what was the change. So let's start with 2021, and then we're going to look at 2022. Now, the formula that we're going to make use of here, and we can go to the sheet. We can go to the sheet. Here we go. So it is part of return, right? And if you go down to the bottom of this sheet, you will see that the dividend payout rate, there's two ways that you can calculate this. It's the dividends per share, over earnings per share multiplied with 100, or you can use dividends for the year over net profit after tax multiplied with 100 to get that percentage. I'm going to make use of the first option there, but it's obviously, learners, it is your prerogative, whatever you find easier. Now, this is literally a situation where we're going to compare. We're first going to calculate, and then we are going to explain. So calculation first. Dividend per share over earnings per share multiplied with 100 over 1. Now, let's go to our information. We're going to go to our information. Get here in front of us. Here we go. Okay. There we go. There is the information for 2021 and 2022. So we are going to make use of these figures over here. We're going to make use of these figures over here. Right? And you can even remind yourself by saying pay out policy. Okay? So let's start. 2021. We know what our formula is that we need to use, and now we're just going to go and fill in. We're going to fill in 35 over 58 multiplied with 100 over 1. That first percentage is 60.3% for 2021. And now we're going to see what was the payout policy in 2022. Same formula, 55 over 51 multiplied with 100 over 1 equals 108%. So there you have your calculation. It's that simple, it's that easy. Let's say, for example, you're more comfortable with the calculations. That's not a problem. Do the calculations, but please, please, and I know your teachers ask the same thing, because I ask my learners the same thing. Just try providing explanation. Just try, guess, but never leave a space open, because that is 2 marks. You could possibly get a part mark, or you could get the full marks, but by leaving it open, you are literally throwing away that 2 marks that could cause you to pass or get that that bachelor pass you want in accounting, or even that distinction that you want in accounting. Now, let's go a little bit further, and we see what does this mean, though? What does this mean? Okay, so what exactly does this mean? More than 50% of the earnings was paid out, and that was in 2021. Now, in 2022, more than the total earnings was paid out. Now, learners, you show this calculation, but I'm also going to show you another calculation, or not even a calculation, just wording. But that's not going to get you the full marks. This will get you the full marks. This will get you the full marks. I'm also just going to show you another option, but unfortunately, you're not going to get the full marks there. But if you provide this, you will still get a mark. This will get you a total of 4 marks. Okay? The next option that I'm going to show you, you're not going to get full marks, but you might get some part marks. Okay? And it says the following over here. So, four cents. So, am I now at the right spot here? Yes. Okay. For 2021, only 23 cents of the 58 cents is being retained. So by saying just this, you can get a mark over here. But obviously, you are all clever, and you're going to remember that every time you see dividend payout policy, you are going to remember this calculation, this formula, and you are going to get those full 4 marks because you have what it takes. That is what you could have said at 2021 for 1 mark only, unfortunately. And then for 2022, 4 cents of the earnings have 4 cents of the earnings of the previous year has also been paid out. So an answer like this would only give you 1 mark. So my suggestion to you is always go for full marks. Do your utmost to get the full marks for this question. And I'm telling you, learners, the chances of you getting a question regarding the dividend payout policy is definitely there. So make sure you get those 4 marks. And it's such a simple calculation. You can definitely do it. Now let's move on. Let's see what they say. Explain why the directors decided to change the policy. State 1 point with figures. Now they only want 1 point. It doesn't help you write down 3, 4, 5 points, but it's not answering, giving the answer to the question. So I'm going to give you 2 options, right? But I also want you to focus on focusing on only giving 1 point, but I'll give you more than 1 option, right? So let's quickly go and see. Let's go look at the information, the indicators that they did give us here. For example, the EPS, there was a drop in the EPS from 2021 to 2022, and that we can obviously down. So what are we writing down? We are first quoting the financial indicator, and then we are indicating the trend, and we are also providing figures. So let's quickly do that. The EPS. There was a decrease of 7 cents from 2021 to 2022. So there's the first option that you could give. Then as well, you can go a little bit further and you can go and look at the return on shareholders' equity. The return on shareholders' equity could have also caused the directors to change the payout policy. Why? We calculated the return on shareholders' equity a little bit earlier. You would see that there was a drop or a decrease in return that shareholders could obviously get. Look at that. There was a drop. So it decreased from 6.2% to 4.5%. We're going to write that down. So that's another option. I'm not saying write down all the options. I'm just saying this is what you could answer. So I'm going to give you a last option as well. So the return on shareholders' equity. There was a decrease of 1.7%. From 2021, and you provide the percentage, 6.2% to 4.5% in 2022. And then lastly, go and look at, in a case like this, go and look at the market price. The market price or the price according to the JSE. So there's your market price. Look what happened to the market price. In 2021, the market price was 1,030 cents. And now in 2022, the market price went down to only 1,000 cents. So the market price or the JSE, Johannesburg Stock Exchange, price, right? That is also something that it could have caused them to change the policy. So I'm going to leave it here at the bottom. Market price. There was a decline. Decreased from 1,030 cents in 2021 to 1,000 cents in 2022. You could have also said market price dropped with 30 cents, just to keep it simple. So there are your options that you could answer in a case like this. So you can go and choose any one of these as an answer and you would get your 2 marks. But you need to know that when it comes to our policy, these are the indicators that has an effect on the payout policy, your earnings per share or your return on shareholders' equity. And I would like to encourage you to always go and look at the return on shareholders' equity, as well as followed by the market price or your earnings per share. And once again, there you get 2 marks just by quoting a financial indicator and showing its trends as well as the figures. So there you get a mark, and then you will get a mark for the trend and the figure. Now, doesn't matter which one you used in this case or will use in this case. But learners, please know that a question like this will most definitely be in your September paper or at the end of the year. Now, I'm going to challenge the learners. I think there's only a few minutes left of today. I think maybe 5 minutes. Oh, my goodness. Time goes by so fast when you are enjoying what you are doing. And I really hope you all enjoyed today. I know I might have gone a little bit slower today, but I would rather go slower and you understand better than I go too fast and you don't understand and you're not anything. So the last 5 minutes before we hang up or before we say our goodbyes, I would like you to go to page number 8. I would like you to go to page number 8, and then I would like you to go down to 2.3.2. So here they ask you, explain your opinion on which company has the best dividend payout policy. So I would like you, and I want to see which school is going to be able to answer this for us. We literally have, I think, 5 minutes, Mr. Royson. Am I right?
Yes, you're correct, Ms. Meyer.
Thank you so much. So, learners, let's see if you learned something today, whether this question that will most definitely be either in your September or at the end of the year exam, whether you have learned something and whether you will be able to grab this question and just get your total full marks and just be excellent at it. So I'm going to give you 5 minutes. I want the answer before we say goodbye to one another. The information you need is provided right here at the bottom. So I will just give you a small little tip because I can't leave you without. Go and look at this. And maybe also separate the space where you need to provide your answer. So I'm going to give you this, and you go and do what I know you can do. So go for it. Quickly separated or divided my space, working space, into two, and then optimum. And there you can clearly compare the two with each other. So with Horizon, we had 65 DPS over EPS multiplied with 100. And that's going to give us the 67% that one of the schools mentioned. And Optima was 80 cents over 83 multiplied with your 100, it gives me 96%. Yes, Optima has the better dividend payout policy. So well done to everybody who said Optima is the one with a better payout policy. I would like to really just take this opportunity to thank all of you for this afternoon. I'm super excited to go through the next topic with you guys all tomorrow. Thank you very much. It was lovely to have all of you. And once again, teachers, thank you for all your contributions you are making to your learners. It's really, it's working. Thank you so much.